This is a production of WKNO Memphis. Production funding for Behind the Headlines is made possible in part by the WKNO Production Fund, the WKNO Endowment Fund, and by viewers like you. Thank you.
Will the mayor's cost-cutting strategies win the support of the unions? Recently released figures show the devastating impact of the recession on Black Memphians. Reaction to the commercial appeal story on the role of Ernest Withers as an FBI informant. And former Mayor Willie Herenton has a new career. Those stories and more coming up on Behind the Headlines. Hello, I'm Eric Barnes, publisher of the Memphis Daily News. Welcome to Behind the Headlines, where we talk to some of the journalists who covered the biggest stories of the week. Let's start by introducing our panel. Bill Dries of the Memphis Daily News. Les Smith, Fox 13 News. Amos Maki, The Commercial Appeal. And Jackson Baker from the Memphis Flyer. Welcome. Our first story tonight, we all know Mayor Wharton has some tough decisions to make with the budget. Amos, you've been covering the story. Why don't you walk us through where we are?
I have. The mayor is still looking for ways to raise $57 million for the school system, massive amount, about 9% of the city's overall budget. We got a few hints of what might happen yesterday during a meeting with the mayor and Superintendent Kreiner Cash. The two men said the city and the school district were working out an installment plan to allow the city to pay the money over a period of years. Mayor Wharton said yesterday that he would not categorically rule in a tax increase. He's asked city division directors to look for ways to make cuts to help close the gap. So we're still in a wait-and-see mode. The meeting yesterday was pretty productive. The two men, Cash and Wharton, said besides funding, there's a lot of areas where the city and the school system are working together. So it's not a completely dysfunctional relationship.
There was a lot of symbolism in that meeting yesterday, wasn't there? A sense that, look, there's been a difference of opinion, but we're coming together. We're on the same page. So as much of tangible things that maybe came out of the meeting, the symbolism of it is that they're trying to turn a new page. Is that correct?
That was a big part of it, what they call the optics of the moment.
The Cash, the optics?
Yeah, the optics of the moment.
Great.
Cash and Mayor Wharton together. This followed a very heated city council meeting on Tuesday, where school officials and city council members were at each other's throats, and it was got pretty heated.
They're not quite as peaceful yet.
No, not nearly as friendly as Cash and Wharton, who've worked together on several issues.
They
appear to be.
Yeah. And that's the whole other kind of cautionary part of this tale, is that there are other players involved in this, the chief among them being the 13-member city council. Cash and Wharton can come to a common purpose, as they call it, on this, but ultimately whatever plan he comes up with has to go before the city council for approval. And some of the council members, as we said last week, are going to have their own ideas about this, particularly if Wharton is forced to propose some kind of one-time tax increase. And there's even some question about if he does a tax increase, if it can indeed be limited to a one-time tax increase, because this is revenue that they'll have to keep coming up with.
Right.
The other at the city council, and without getting too much into the complexities, they've approved next year's city school budget. Is that correct? But they put the city council tried to assert some authority about how that money's going to be spent. Is that correct?
They put some strings on it that for this particular situation don't mean a whole lot. What the council said was, yeah, we approve your $891 million operating budget. That's go ahead and get your federal and state funding, and we've approved you using $9.1 million of your reserve fund, but only $9.1 million. Well, the bottom line on that is that's how much the school system wanted to use. But the council's trying to insert some meaning here to say that we have a state attorney general's opinion that says we can control how much of your reserves you use. The school system categorically rejects that. But Wharton and Cash were trying to get this back on center and saying, look, we're really not paying any attention to that for now. We want to get past this moment and into a better relationship.
And do we have a fix on what the number is going to be? You know, 57 seems to be the high number, 57 million. It could be less than that. Is that still just being worked through?
They're working on that right now. City schools people will tell you absolutely 100% they owe us $57.4 million.
Don't forget the point four.
That's the city council and their attorney would disagree based on school attendance and statements made by schools officials during court proceedings.
The number may change, but 57 is going to be the ballpark figure where they end up. Now, in terms of the new budget that they approved, the Memphis share of that is approximately $78 million, which is about 8 to 9% of the total amount of funding in the budget.
Meanwhile, did I read correctly that Craner Cash has had, the superintendent of the city schools, has had his contract extended? Is that correct? I think I saw that this morning.
There's going to be a move to extend his contract.
Okay.
What he's had is his annual evaluation, and he got a grade of a B in it, and the school board with one.
So they literally give him letter grades?
Yeah.
Oh, that's good. It's a nice touch.
It's what amounts to a letter grade with a school system, a letter grade. But it's an endorsement of his performance, but more importantly, it's an endorsement that they're going to stick by his reform agenda now that some of the newness has kind of worn off, the new reform smell, if you will, has worn off of it. They're in for some tough going because, you know, the new higher standards are about to clock in and we're about to get some lower test scores for all school systems,
right.
So the going's going to get get tough.
Right. Well, we will come back to that that story, certainly, as the weeks and months go by. On to our next topic, which is we, on our weekly edition, did a big story coming out about the impact of the recession, particularly on the African-American community in Memphis and nationally, but we, of course, are focused on Memphis. Let's have Bill, you introduce us to that.
It's the news story in our weekly, the Memphis News, done by Jonathan Devon. And it is numbers that we have been familiar with in general about the impact of this recession on African Americans in Memphis in particular. Our overall unemployment figures for Memphis just got to where they're at the Tennessee average and the national average in the most recent figures that are out. We're under double digits in Shelby County. That is not the case for black unemployment figures in Memphis and Shelby County, not at all. It's still in double digits, and that's a very stubborn number that really is going to take a lot of work to bring down. The figures are pretty dismal for the impact of this recession on African Americans.
There was a story in the New York Times back in May that focused on the national problem and partly focused on Memphis and talked about the median wealth among African Americans fell 77% over through this recession, which is, you know, median wealth for everyone fell, but it was just a more dramatic fall. The other thing we talked about in the story is, you know, that the African American community nationally and in Memphis was particularly hard hit by the housing crisis and by, you know, subprime lending. That was one of the, you know, it's for most people the biggest asset they have, their biggest savings, and the preponderance of subprime lending in the African-American community, some would say the targeting of subprime lending in the African-American community is coming to roost, I guess.
Well, I think the deal is that this article, to me, when I read it, points up the differences in philosophy when it comes to finances for African-Americans as opposed to white people. There is a much, African-Americans look at money not in the long-term type of investment role. Basically because they're forced into that position. They don't have a financial background. They don't have the rich uncle who owned the company, who owned this and that. So they have to, it's kind of keep your head above water in some circumstances, not only on a personal level, but also if you own a business, it's that same thing.
Yeah, we had Luke Yancey from the Mid-South Minority Business Council who said that, you know, there's typically in the African-American community, it's first-generation wealth.
Right.
So when you hit a recession, there's not as much cushion. And it was a simple, but for me, really eye-opening statement
It
makes sense.
Yeah.
And to go even further. In our op-ed Q&A, we talked with Tamika Hart with the Memphis Urban League, and the Urban League annually points out this gap nationally, not just in Memphis. And her point to me about that was, yes, we have some first-generation African-Americans who are doing well, but what do they know in terms of financial habits? They know what their parents had to do in order to keep the wolf from the door. And so as a result, she says that she's seen figures that indicate that African-American women who are doing well still have a problem with debt that is a result basically of habit, even though mm-hmm. they're doing better.
You know, right. It strikes me this is yet another aspect of the last hired, first fired syndrome. There's a very striking story, and that point that you brought out, Eric, black wealth tends to be first generation wealth. And one of the people quoted in that story was Marvell Mitchell, who is a very exceptional person. It reminded me of how deep that field of congressional candidates was against Steve Cohen in 2006. He was about number five on that mm-hmm. list, but he was a real success figure. If he said to scale back, basically from hardware to servicing that hardware, that indicates the kind of retrenchment that's going on across an entire body of people. And again, as Les pointed out, who have not yet developed the habits that several people who've had money, used money for several generations have had. And so consequently, they're losing out on the American dream, right. having just got a sniff of it.
Right, right. Well, it's a great story, and we'll talk more about this issue and hopefully talk about some positive news as the months go by in the economy. Our next topic is jobs, and it's not the unemployment numbers. It's the reemployment of one notable Memphian, former mayor, Willie Herenton.
Yeah, speaking of unemployment and what you do when you're out of work, Willie Herenton. What would he do? What would you do if you're Willie Herenton and you wanted to restore your viability, to recover your lost influence, and to maintain your immersion in the body politic? You would do what he is about to do, become a talk show host. he's joining the broadcast industry, and I was very lucky to have an interview with him last week in which he divulged all this to me, and I talked to the people at Flynn Broadcasting who are going to be his employees.
And it's a radio show?
It's a radio show 5 days a week at noon.
Daily?
Daily. Daily.
Now, the only broadcast guy at this table is laughing. So there's
but, you know, all of us here, I think, have been to press conferences in which Herenton is a central figure. And yeah. He holds his own in any kind of situation where there is conversation going, group conversation. I can tell you I've had a lot of conversations with him of various kinds right. over the years, and he maintains a dialogue. That's all you need to do. He's going to get an audience because no one has a higher profile, a hotter profile than he does.
Well, yeah, and well, Bill, I said no one at the table has done broadcasting. You're in print now, but you did radio for many years.
22 years.
Give or take. What's your take? And you've covered Herenton for, I think, all of his terms, I believe you covered
since he was with the school system. Jackson makes an interesting point. He does hold his own in press conferences. A radio talk show, a daily radio talk show, is a very different matter, I think. Radio looks easy when you work around people who have done it well. Radio talk shows are very hard to maintain in terms of an audience and in terms of listener interest. I mean, you know, I think Herenton has the same problem with this that he had in the congressional race, and that is he ran for Congress without still being mayor. If he were still mayor and he were doing a daily radio talk show, this might be more fascinating and might probably have a longer life than I think it's going to have. My prediction is that the talk show won't last very long, and there is some precedent for this. I remember at WHBQ radio when I worked there in the late 80s, we had a program director who thought it will be a great idea for us to look at these last elections in 1986 that we had at the time. He looked at the sheriff's race and said, well, Gene Barksdale lost in a close race to Jack Owens. And Gene got this many votes, so therefore that means this many listeners.
Listen, right.
So they put Gene on a morning talk show with Ron Jordan, who was Peck's bad boy of radio at the time. And the show was pretty much a disaster.
Well, that was Herenton. Will he have a partner in this, or will he be solo?
He will be a solo, but let me take exception to what Bill has said. I do disagree because Bill Willie Herenton is a friend of mine. I know Willie Herenton. And he is no Gene Barksdale. Gene Barksdale was a relatively colorless individual, no matter how many votes he got. Willie Herenton actually enjoys repartee and is pretty good at it, all things considered.
There is no doubt. I spent almost 3 years with the guy on a daily basis. He can be very engaging and very entertaining. And let's not forget, he was mayor for 15 years. People still like the guy in a lot of corners of this city.
He got very few votes. There's a part of this that, and I think we struggle with the paper. I think everyone struggles with it, and we struggled with it in the congressional campaign, that he was, in essence, not campaigning. He was not raising money. He lost by a landslide. And yet we do it right now. We put this attention on him because of who this it sells, maybe, or it's attractive. I always question this kind of attention.
I got to say, just very quickly, another thing I disagree with. If he had a talk show host as mayor, he would have done what every other public official with a talk show does, talk dull public interest stuff. He's liberated now. I think that's a huge difference.
But the repartee is going to be about Willie
Herenton. And that's my point. If it's just about the legacy of Willie Herenton,
it's over. All right. We'll come back to this. We'll do some reviews. Memphis Magazine, look for it. There's the plug. On to a big story this week in Mr. Herenton's favorite paper, The Commercial Appeal. Mark Perskia could not be here today, but the lead investigative reporter for the CA uncovered a series of documents that show how Ernest Withers, the acclaimed photographer, was an informant, a paid informant for the FBI. It was a kind of shocking and interesting story. Let's have Les walk us through the story, and then we'll talk about it.
Shocking and interesting, some dismay in a lot of quarters, especially about the timing of the story. In a couple of weeks, the Ernest Withers Museum, which is some $25, $35 million project. Now, the first phase of that opening will be in a couple of weeks. So that upset the family a great deal. But basically, what we see here, apparently the FBI, these documents confirm that he worked or informed for the FBI from the period of 1968 to 1970. Basically, most of this apparently was giving them information on the Invaders, which was a militant local black group that they didn't have any information on. I don't even remember the times. I mean, in that period of time, there were a number of black splinter groups popping up all over the country. There was talk of Black Power, Stokely Carmichael, H. Rapp Brown, and the FBI was trying to keep tabs on all this. Plus, they were trying to keep tabs on Martin Luther King. Now, we want to do something here. You know, when this story came out, everybody went running to their archives to see, hey, maybe he gave us something that we just didn't see at the time. And our good friends here at WKNO went through their library. They came up with two very interesting clips. And the first clip that we want to give you, and we can discuss after it runs, is that Withers in an interview was asked about King's relationship with the media and his own relationship with Dr. King. If we can run that clip right now.
See, he was not a really heavy privatized person. He was privatized for the general public. Uh-huh. But he was socially and reflective and acceptable to men of the media, both black and white. Huh. You know, so we had no problem with him. Like I said, as well as I knew him, we were not buddy-buddies.
All right, so we understand that they weren't bosom buddies. King, obviously there were people around King. How could he be bosom buddies? But yet at the same time, here's the situation. He definitely needed them as much as they needed him, because he wanted to keep that nonviolent, you know, aspect alive. So the media were there. But here comes the second clip that we're going to show you. And I think this is the one you go, okay, bingo here. This is the one that he talks about, refers to when he couldn't be an informant for the Memphis Police Department.
And he is a former police officer, working as a photographer, and he's talking about that.
One of the original eight Negroes hired at the time by the Memphis Police Department.
I had continued to grow as a photographer because one reason, one of the sore spots of my being a policeman was that they could not use me in an undercover bracket because more people knew me image-wise than the rest of them.
So it's interesting stuff. Mm-hmm. Let's talk about it. What was your reaction when you heard those clips and
well, get some other feedback? The immediate reaction I think that we all had was, okay, he was too well known for the Memphis Police Department to be an informant, but for the FBI?
That's what the FBI counted on, was his closeness to the civil rights movement.
That's a perfect cover story. Perfect. You know, I couldn't be undercover because I couldn't get away with what he got away with.
And let's remember, we know now in hindsight that the FBI was spying on Americans who were engaged in legitimate political dissent.
That's right.
At the time that this was happening, 1968 to 1970, most Americans weren't aware of it. King had been made aware of it, I think, in 1964, that the FBI was out to get him, and was utterly floored for a brief time by the knowledge that they had been recording conversations, had been tapping phones. I mean, people I've talked to and who were in the movement at the time were aware of it to some degree, but not to the vast extent that came out in the post-Watergate revelations.
Right, and this was J. Edgar Hoover's FBI. It was an interesting historical perspective to be reminded of that kind of intrusion that was going on from the FBI that came out of essentially the communist era and then went into the civil rights era and the widespread use of informants and the widespread use of agents and spying and no control. No legislative oversight, no executive oversight of what the FBI was doing at the time.
I wanted to bring up the point that a number of African-American black newspapers at the time, in the early 60s and the late 50s, where most of the material of black writers and black photographers was published, some of those organizations had communist ties, or at least were suspected of having communist ties, or being communist financed. And so, with Withers selling, through that and all that, communism probably was a reason, as Amos, I think, pointed out.
Some of that speaks to maybe Withers' motivation to cooperate as well. There's been a lot of speculation about why did he do this. Some have said maybe it's money. He had a large family, large number of kids. But there's also the question of, do you say no to Hoover's FBI, which can make your life hell?
Richard Thompson of the Mediaverse blog pointed out, looking at those excerpts that were in the commercial appeal, there aren't any dynamite revelations that it was kind of a small talk that he distributed to the FBI.
The FBI wanted to build up the invaders as a group that was as important as the Black Panthers. The Black Panthers became an obsession for the FBI after King's assassination, and I don't think it's any overstatement to say that the organization, that the FBI declared war on the Panthers. The invaders were a far less effective organization. Some of the FBI documents indicate that the FBI actually called in the members at one point to talk to them and found out, well, the members said, we haven't had anything to talk about in months. We haven't even met
many of the members are now pillars of the community.
Sweet Willie Wine, the city council honored him in the last few years.
Plus, people said that Andrew Young was quoted as saying, hey, we were open. There wasn't really anything that we were trying to hide anyway.
And Andrew Young said, hey, I don't hold it against the guy if he wanted to make a little bit of money.
Exactly.
And that goes into the legacy question of, so many of us really, knowing it or not, we have seen the civil rights era through Ernest Withers' work and through his photos. And so does this harm that legacy? I mean, where is the difference between art and him as a man and as a person?
The pictures speak for themselves. There is no more iconic image on film than that long spread of the mass marchers behind the I Am a Man sign. What he did distributing small talk to the FBI, who were, I guess, more generous with their dollars than he was with real information, was insignificant compared to what he did as an artist.
Those photos were transmitted all over the world, gave life and breath to the movement. It was something people could see. These are men. They're trying to work to take care of themselves with respect and dignity. You can't ever leave that talk out of the equation. That's what he did. Those photos are still iconic to this day.
Whatever he may have done, I know, and we don't know from any of what we've seen in that expose. I mean, was it some historical changing kind of information that he passed along? We'll never know.
I will leave the question of legacy to others. I think it will have some impact on the legacy, but I think the irony here is that Mr. Withers really didn't think that much about his legacy. If you talk to him about the people he photographed, He rarely talked about, I did this angle or I lit it this way. He always talked about the people in the photographs, and he had a phenomenal memory. And yes, if you asked him about any of the people that he photographed, King or Aaron, any of the others, as we saw in the clip, he certainly did not put them on a pedestal. No. The only person that he photographed that came anywhere close to that was Sam Cooke. He really was very fond of Sam Cooke and regarded Sam Cooke as a stellar individual. The rest, if you asked him if they had feet of clay, he would tell you, and he would sometimes tell you in more detail than you might have cared to know.
Yeah, there's a very interesting thing going on in the black community right now. I happened to see last night Dr. Yahweh, the former Sweet Willie Wine, and I asked him about it. He does not believe that Withers actually did it. It's in black and white.
Yeah, and we'll end it there. It's a fascinating story about Ernest Withers and about a time in American history,
yes,
and it really is worth a read. Our last story tonight, briefly, is a tale of two fairs. We've got two fairs now in the Memphis area. One, but we will come back to that next week. We will go through our the state of
It'll
the two fairs.
It'll still be going
then.
On.
exactly. It'll still be going on.
It'll still be going on.
That is all the time we have tonight. I want to thank our panelists. I want to thank you for tuning in. And I ask you to stay plugged in and get topic and guest information from WKNO.org. You can get to our Twitter feed. You can get to our Facebook page. You can sign up for a free weekly newsletter. Thank you for watching Behind the Headlines. I'm Eric Barnes. Good night.